This week on Maker Update, adding a kick to virtual reality, Arduino 2.0, a rotary cell phone to call your own, hardscrabble keyboards, rolling the dice, and better toast from machine learning. Hello and welcome back to Maker Update. I'm Tyler Weingarner, and I hope you're all doing great. Do you ever look at one of these shows and realize you could be using your tools in ways you never thought of? That's what I got out of putting this one together, and I can't wait to get into it. So let's check out the project of the week. Over the past few years, we've seen a number of DIY VR controllers and accessories, like Lucas VR Tech's Haptic Gloves. So it only makes sense that they'd start to get a little more specialized, like this haptic feedback handgun by Robert Enriquez. What really gets me about this project, well, other than adding immersion to VR first-person shooters, is how simple it is. Not that there isn't a ton of clever engineering going on here, but it's executed without a lot of extra complication. The handgun is basically an attachment for the basic Oculus Quest controller. When the player pulls the trigger, that makes the action happen in the game. Then some middleware intercepts the signal, which sends a trigger to the ESP32 that's in the handgun, which then activates the haptic interaction from the electric blowback motor. An electric blowback motor is an electric geared motor that pulls back a spring-loaded piston. They're typically found in airsoft guns to simulate recoil. He's scavenged the motor and the cosmetic body of the haptic handgun from a laser tag pistol. The rest of the construction is almost as simple as the code. The Quest hand controller remains completely untouched. Everything connects to the pistol grip add-on via a strong neodymium magnet. There's a simple freeform circuit to trigger the blowback motor with the correct voltage, a 6-volt battery with a step-up converter, a battery indicator, and a toggle switch. It's all fairly cheap too, at just $70, and it looks pretty easy to construct. And from a few gameplay demos, the feedback looks great too. Robert provides everything you need to replicate the build on his GitHub repo. Check out the links down in the description. Now for some news, the Arduino team have finally released version 2.0 of the Arduino IDE, with a handful of new features that should bring it up to modern standards and improve the overall experience. The editor now features autocompletes, making it easier to write your code, automatic linking to variable and function declarations, a dark mode, and more. There's also a serial plotter for you to diagnose your project, and it can be used simultaneously with the serial monitor. The desktop IDE can integrate with the Arduino cloud, so you can easily work on your sketches across multiple computers. More projects. On Adafruit, I found this project by the Ruiz brothers to build a Raspberry Pi media server using Plex and an SSD. This might be a bit of a flex considering the current state of Raspberry Pi availability, but this is one of my favorite classic Pi projects. However, the Ruiz brothers have added on all of the extra bells and whistles. There's a 1.9-inch TFT display that can report on the Pi status like temperature, memory, and storage capacity. Plus, it can display GIFs and more. There's also a power button that gracefully shuts the Pi down for maintenance. It's a cool project and a great looking build. Justine Haupt has an update on her rotary cell phone project from a few years ago. After fielding dozens and dozens of requests to sell or produce a kit for the device, she's taken on the task of redesigning the project so she can turn it into just that. It's all newly manufactured with custom parts. The housing is injection molded and it can be had in a variety of colors. And while it's not a smartphone, it now supports LTE, so it should be compatible with mobile networks for another 10 years. Not only does it ring an actual bell when receiving a call, but it also lights up for accessibility. There's even an SD card slot for maintaining a contact list. It's not cheap, but you can pre-order the kit now for $390. Everything is open source though, so if you don't want to wait, you don't have to. Evan and Katelyn just released a video where they made this gorgeous Scrabble-themed wooden mechanical keyboard. The video glosses over all the electronic details about making your own mechanical keyboard, so it's all about customization. The keycaps themselves are a combination of laser-cut wood with a variety of veneers for different colors, with a glued-in 3D printed insert to interface with the key switch. That's a lot of digital fabrication to throw at this, but it also makes the execution of it fairly accessible. They could have stopped there, but they wanted to keep the theme going with a wooden frame for the keyboard. They cut that out on a CNC router and then came up with a simple but clever setup to cut a hole for the power cable. After a bit of rounding and finishing, they did the final reveal and it looks fantastic. They provide all the files for their Patreon supporters, but it seems like you could probably reverse engineer this if you wanted to build your own with your own design. Time for some tips and tools. On YouTube, Uncle Jessy has a tip for using wood glue for cleaning spilled resin off of your SLA printer's screen. Sometimes you can miss a drip or two when emptying your resin vat, which can leave these hardened blobs of resin behind. The idea is that you spread out a thin layer of wood glue across your screen, covering the spots of cured resin. You let that dry and then peel it up afterwards. He tried a few different brands of wood glue, and some worked better than others. This technique seems a little more fussy than practical, but he also shares some more traditional techniques for removing these pesky resin spots. On his YouTube channel, JSK Koubou has a guide on making these unique tools out of basic hardware, stuff like nuts, bolts, and coupling nuts. The first one is sort of a sharpened punch that can be used to cut hexagonal holes, perfect for countersinking the heads of hex bolts into wooden hardware. The second is a jig that allows him to make circular cutouts on the edge of a round shape. What's amazing is how he's only using some basic tools to do this. It's a great way to think differently about what you have and what you can do with it. From Altium Academy, they have a video on the most common beginner mistakes in PCB design. One of the biggest ones is maintaining proper spacing of your traces. If you have your traces too close together for too long of a run, you can have signals interfere with one another. Another consideration is trace width. Thinner traces can be less affected by EMI than thicker traces, but thicker traces can carry more current, useful for power connections. A lot of this is pretty obvious for seasoned PCB designers, but for folks just starting out, or anyone who hasn't made that first leap yet, this seems like a ton of useful info. And finally, we have a fun product and video from Simone Yetch and Laura Kampf for a set of metal dice that can help you get out of your creative rut. If you want to build something and you don't know what you want to build, give these three dice a roll and see if they give you a couple of good prompts to start brainstorming. In the video, they put them to the test and try out two different approaches to the same project. This is a super fun video and a great product. I know it's probably way too early to talk about the gift-giving season, but keep this one on your list of gifts to give, or maybe put it on your own list. For this week's Digi-Key Spotlight, Shawn, Hymel is using an array of sensors and machine learning to achieve the perfect piece of toast. If you're using one of these traditional toasters that uses a bimetal switch, they can get a little bit fiddly, or you might miss it when someone adjusts their settings. So he's building a device that will detect when the toast is at that perfect mouth-watering caramelization. The process begins by teaching the machine learning model the precise point when the bread shifts from toasted to burnt. And it's neat to be able to analyze all the different data streams: humidity, CO2, and volatile organic compounds. Apparently, the real key is looking for ammonia, since that spikes when things are starting to burn. It's a fun project and process. Check it out. All right, and that is going to do it for this week's show. I had a lot of fun with this one, and I hope you did too. If you did, give us a thumbs up, hit subscribe, and leave us a comment. Tell us about something that you saw that made you think about one of your favorite tools differently. Big thanks to Digi-Key for supporting the show and to you for watching. Take care, and we'll see you soon.